the Florida court would construe his letter of November 18th as merely an offer to the board to revise his contract and allow for there to be an earlier separation. Offer, acceptance, contract, sort of basic concepts under Florida law. Prior to the time that the board, as a group, had an opportunity to evaluate, discuss, and take any action on that offer, Mr. Bridges withdrew the offer. And that was made very clear in the two communications that he forwarded to you again on the 29th and December 8th. Thus, I believe a Florida court would look at this and would say that there's really nothing on the table with respect to that issue for the board to act on. It's fairly straightforward. I don't know that there's any, I'm happy to answer any questions that may relate to that issue. But that leads us to the next point, and that is, where do we stand? I mean, what does this look like? And it's my sense and opinion that you have an employment agreement with Mr. Bridges. It was entered into on March 22nd of 2011 when the board approved it. And that document, which was attached to the memo, governs the party's rights, responsibilities, duties, and obligations. And under my understanding of the contract and the words in the contract, Mr. Bridges' current employment agreement is term, or is in effect, until June 30th of 2019. Mr. Bridges did advise the board, as he is required to do under his employment agreement, on October 31st of this year, of the notice that to the board members that if you all have a desire to non-renew or notify me of your intent to non-renew the agreement, then you need to do that before January 1st. In this instance, January 1st of 2017. Therefore, if the board took no action, which that's what's happened over the previous years, the contract by its terms would automatically extend for one additional year, which means that it would go forward until June 30th of 2020. So the question is, today we're here. This is the only board meeting that I'm aware of, not this meeting right here, but the meeting that you have this evening, is the only meeting I'm aware of that you have scheduled for the month of December that's prior to January 1st of 2017. So depending on what the board wants to do, today would be the day, if you were so inclined, to take action. And that action would be either a notice of intent to non-renew Mr. Bridges' employment agreement, provide him that notice, and the contract is then automatically terminated as of June 30th of 2019. A majority of the board could determine we don't want to take any action. We're satisfied with what the current situation is, and if that were the case, then the contract would automatically renew for one additional year or go to June 30th of 2020. And so that's sort of where we are. I hope that helps put in context. I was a little reluctant to answer any hypothetical questions or try to postulate or opine on things that I don't really have full facts on or that are not squarely before me or that are not a majority of the board's concerns. So I leave it at that. And
So there's a lot of conversation about it in the media, and I felt like we needed to bring it before the board to have discussion.
Sure.
So that we can get a consensus on where we're going as it relates to Mr. Bridges. So now the floor is open for any discussion that any board member would like to have on this matter.
Well, I guess I'll go first on this. As I see this, there are two issues. The first is the contract, and actually that goes for Carol's contract as well. She's also on the automatically renewing year issue. It's been no secret that I've been dissatisfied with Mr. Bridges' performance as the attorney, but that's a different issue for right now than the contract itself. I guess my question to all of you is, did you know that we had an automatically renewing three-year contract?
Yes.
Of course.
Sure we did.
Sure.
And you knew that it had a $450,000 buyout in it? like, if we ever wanted to part ways with him, that we were going to have to pay him $400, the full value.
Sure.
That's standard procedure.
Standard three-year contract.
I don't think our superintendent's contract automatically renewed every year.
Hers is a different contract.
Three-year contract.
Well, then it's not standard.
I'm saying for attorneys.
The contract that, just may interject, and again, this, there are some further looking, but I believe that the contract that the school board had with its then superintendent, Dr. Nichols, which was when this agreement was approved, was similar in its terms. Certainly, as Mr. Townsend indicated, the internal auditor's contract, I believe, is the same. I did have a brief opportunity to reach out to other school board attorneys and, you know, school board attorneys throughout the state, and I did receive some feedback. The school board for the Lee County school system, which has approximately 89,000 students, that agreement is substantially the same as the agreement in terms of that provision. That attorney actually...
The
three-year period that automatic, you know, the fact that the board has to notify prior to January, or may have been an April date, but they have to notify the attorney, and if they don't, the agreement automatically goes for an additional year.
Do they also have the full payout of the three years?
Well, and I'm not clear, and I'm trying to answer that. When you say that there's a requirement to buy out, I look at that perhaps a little differently. The agreement that's with Mr. Bridges is, there are, as I noted in my outline or in my memo, there are about four instances when the agreement can be terminated. The parties can mutually agree. Of course, that's basic contract principles. If one party is agreeable to the other, they agree, and that happens. If Mr. Bridges were to die or become substantially disabled during the term of his agreement, they would terminate. Mr. Bridges can terminate the agreement by providing 5 months prior notice, or the board can terminate the agreement, but only if they find in writing, and they have to provide these charges to Mr. Bridges, if there was a substantial breach of contract or there was just cause. Just cause I characterize like what's in the Florida statutes for teacher contracts under section 1012.33, and they list a series of things that rise to the level of what would be just cause. I don't believe there's anything in the contract that would permit the board to terminate the agreement for its convenience or for no reason. And I think if the board were to do that, and again, I don't want to opine on hypothetical questions, but if a majority of the board were inclined to do that, I think that would be viewed as a breach of contract under the terms of the agreement as I see it. And then when you get into that situation, you then would have damages, which is, you know, under Florida law, what is your measure of damage? And then that's when you get into looking at what would be the compensation or the monies that might have been otherwise owed through the term of the employment. So it's it's a very different...
Mr. Murphy, if I could, I think the salient issue here is the ability to terminate for convenience. Mm-hmm. And I think Mrs. Leroy's contract had that clause, which was why she got the 5 months severance pay.
Correct. Well, and that's sort of in employment contracts. It is not unusual for public bodies to have provisions in contracts that allow them to terminate employment agreements for their convenience. In other words, they don't have to have any reason. You could just decide we don't want to do that and do it. But the quid pro quo for that, generally, is that there is some severance provision, or there is some contractual provision in that agreement that says, look, if we do that, we're going to have to pay you this sum of money. That's not in this agreement. Now, not to complicate matters, but on July 1st of 2011, our Florida legislature enacted 215.425, which was a statute, or is a statute, that says if you have such provisions in agreements with agencies or public employers, then you can only have 20 weeks of compensation for severance provisions. Of course, if you read the statute in its introductory paragraphs indicates that those are only and I have a copy just here so I can read it. I have a good memory, but I don't like to test it. This section, or this statute, does not apply to a bonus or severance pay that is paid wholly from non-tax revenues and non-state appropriated funds. So you may ask yourself the question, well, I've heard of, you know, Hillsborough County, they paid that superintendent $1 million, or I've heard when, you know, if that were the case, and of course I'm not opining on that, there may have been instances where there were revenues or funds paid that were either non-tax revenues or non-state appropriated revenues. And that's a little bit, I don't mean to get into the weeds on that, but suffice to say, the provisions of this statute may have to be evaluated, and would, of course, have to be evaluated if you were terminating an employment agreement in a public agency setting for convenience. And you would, in fact, the statute requires that contracts must have these provisions in them that limit the amount of severance pay. But to get to your point, Board Member Wilson, it's the quid pro quo for the right to terminate for convenience is that you pay some money.
Well, and as I understand it, Mr. Bridges' contract does not have
correct.
That clause.
That is correct.
Those are referred to often as evergreen contracts, and I think at one time they were very popular, although they are less popular today. So,
yes.
I think that's the salient issue, really, is it not?
Sure. Yes.
Yeah.
The consequence of not renewing today is essentially nothing. It like it starts the clock on a three-year contract, right?
Well, actually, yes. If the board were to take a majority of the board were to vote at a meeting that was regular or special meeting to non-renew, then what that would be is, yes, it would say, Mr. Bridges, this contract will terminate as of June 30th of 2019. It will not renew at that time. So it puts a limit on the length, if you will. It cuts off that evergreen aspect of the agreement. Conversely, if the board, majority of the board, determined they were satisfied and didn't want to take any particular action, the contract would automatically renew for an additional year. And, I mean, so that's a policy matter for the board to discuss and review, but you know, that's the contract, I believe, when it was approved on March 22nd of 2011, it was a unanimous vote of the board. And as I said at the time, it was Dr. Nichols who was the superintendent. And so the agreement is before you, and that your characterizations of it are accurate.
Does anybody else have any comments on this issue?
I guess I will say I understand we have one full-time school board attorney. We are a huge district with many, many issues. I've been on the board for 14 years. I see experience, knowledge, intelligence, and the decisions, important decisions that can mean millions of dollars. I see that we have had good, solid attorney advice and direction. He's very conservative, follows the law, tries to give us all the information. I've seen tremendous growth. Anytime I have a question, he will give me both sides, he will tell me the law, and he always says he's not the eighth board member. It's my decision, but he wants me to have all the facts and all the knowledge that it takes to make a good decision, especially on legal issues. So, nobody lasts forever. At some point, Mr. Bridges will be moving on. I know that. But every time we lose that knowledge and experience, it takes a toll on the district. It's a cost. And if and when he goes, in the near or far future, we have to get somebody with as much knowledge and experience as they can, because once again, we have one. We don't have, like many people have, one head attorney and a bank of other attorneys that they can train. We have to get somebody that's ready to hit the job running, we, there's nobody here to train them. So when we go out to get another attorney, I understand that this is the kind of contract that they want. We're not going to get someone with the knowledge and experience and the know-how with a one-year contract and somebody that we can let go because we decide, oh, let's try somebody new. It's a very serious thing. It's the same with getting a superintendent. This is a little different experience that we've had now, so the contract doesn't look the same. But search firms will tell you, these are the kinds of contracts you need to get the quality person that you need in the job. And actually, it works well for both. We could keep him for 5 months. He has to give us 5 months' notice unless it's mutually agreed upon. So I would be careful to change this, because whatever we change to, I don't want, because he's already here, let's give him a lesser contract and wait until we have to go out to get a new lawyer, and then we'll give him a good contract, then we'll change it on him. Because the very smart people check you out more than you check them out sometimes. And they see the history, and they see what you've done. And to me, it would be giving him a vote of lack of confidence. And right now, we've evaluated him for this year. We had no discussion, you know, in November of when he always notifies us when we need to take action. I know you have issues. I really didn't understand them because, quite frankly, some of what I tried to read to find out your issues seemed to me to be inaccurate on the facts, because we were here and experienced those things. And so there was a lot of inaccuracies to my way of looking at what I saw your issues were. So, and we can't talk outside of a meeting, so I know you. We knew that you had issues, but I'm not real sure what they are, because what I read seemed to be inaccurate. But we can discuss it, but that's the part I wanted to say about the dangers of changing it. And in light of this situation, we had no issues. We didn't bring up any in November or October after he notified us. He was evaluated. So that's my position in why I would be hesitant to change anything at this point.
So, I mean, it's kind of
okay, just a couple things. Number one is I purposely did not read the newspaper as I was getting bombarded with calls asking me if I had seen what all my board members were putting in the paper. And I was extremely upset with my group here, who I love dearly, because I don't feel that we should be airing how we feel in the paper before we collectively, as a group of seven, have the opportunity to sit and talk. So I don't know how that started, but I hope that's the first and last time that we air how we feel publicly, because then people call the other ones and say, hey, did you realize so-and-so said this and feels like that and da-da-da. I feel like we've always upheld a certain ethic in this group where we come here and express how we feel. So no, I wasn't about to tell the ledger or anybody else how I feel about a certain subject until I had the time to talk to each one of you and see how everybody felt collectively. Because once again, I am what? One board member out of seven. So number one, I hope that going forward, we don't pull this antic anymore, because it's totally disrespectful to each other and to me and to the people that we're talking about in the paper without giving us a chance collectively to speak. So that's number one. Number two, I understand there's opposing views, and there always are. My question this morning is, as we sit here and we speak, you know, and everybody feels the way they do, and that's fine, but my question is, do we by consensus in this room can decide on Wes's contract, or does it have to be at the public meeting? That's my second question. What's the protocol now that it's raised to this level?
Sure. The contract requires, yes, that if the board is to take any action, and without official action on the contract, that it must be at a meeting, a special or regular meeting of the board, not at this meeting. So if you were to take action on the contract, whatever that action is,
it
must be at a meeting, a special meeting or a regular meeting.
Does it have to have notice?
No, there's no specific notice required.
Since it's a...
For this particular subject, I would guess. And furthermore, the fact that the contract contemplates the board, if it's desirous to act, must do so before January 1st, it would sort of contemplate that. But again, the way... So does that answer your question, Ms. Cunningham?
Yes, absolutely. So if and I'm just going to paraphrase it in non-council terms, if we want to continue the rolling 3 years, we don't have to do anything. If we want to take action and give notice by January 1, it would need to be done at a duly scheduled board meeting tonight.
Correct.
Okay, thank you.
Yes. Just to clarify what she just said, so I'm making sure I understand. There is no need for any action to be taken at all if the majority would like to have the contract just roll over one more year.
That is correct.
Thank you.
I'm going to clarify, you said just one more year. Can you clarify what you meant by that? Because it actually...
Well, this only applies for a one-year extension of the current contract, which would move it from June 30 of 19
so you
to
want
June
to put 30 it
of
to,
20.
To 25.
That's all a rolling contract does, just add a year to it.
I want to, I guess, kind of answer you in order. Laurie, with respect, I don't answer to you. I answer to the people who elected me. I answer to the public who told me they're very unhappy with the way you guys have done things here. And I will not be quiet. I will continue to say what I think. I will continue to say it in a public way. I've made no bones about that, ever. You guys have had a very, very, very bad 4 years. You hired a terrible superintendent and you failed to oversee her. With respect, I think Wes was a part of that. If you had had a good 4 years, if you had had a good last year, you wouldn't be dealing with me now. I would never have run. So I just want to make that clear. I serve the public, not you, not this board.
Mr. Townsend, excuse me this minute. We're going to be civil to one another. You have the right to have your comments, but we're not going to be having comments negatively towards each other. And the same thing for everybody at this table, because if that's the case, we would never, ever get anything accomplished. You want to get something accomplished? Ms. Sellers want to get something accomplished? Ms. Byrd? Ms. Reynolds? Ms. Cunningham? Mr. Harris? And Mr. Wilson? Everybody at this table want to get something accomplished. And if we're at each other's throat, back and forth, nothing will be accomplished. Nothing. So I ask you to please be mindful of what you say, because when you say your words cannot be taken back.
I'm aware of that. I found nothing at all uncivil about being honest and direct. I don't. It's not any kind of personal thing. I'm just being clear. Your vision for how the board should behave is not the board that is not the vision that I share. I am not going to, for the sake of getting along or some sort of false unity in this board, going to be quiet about the things that I think. That's what I was elected to do. I don't find that this is uncivil at all. I think this is direct and helpful. I'm not sure what you consider uncivil about it. But I also want to back us up to the key question at hand. And Hazel, I put aside Wes's performance for a bit, okay? Let's just talk about the contract itself. And this goes for Carol Matthews. In effect, Wes has a lifetime appointment. And Wes, you can correct me if I'm wrong on this, but in our very civil meeting we had, by the way, my understanding was that you said the mechanism for us ending the contract for convenience would be to pay the full value of the contract, which I understand why you would say
that. So. I wish to respond by reading the language from the contract in paragraph 10. Throughout the term of the agreement, the attorney shall be subject to discharge only for substantial breach of contract or for just cause. Notice of discharge shall be given in writing. The attorney has the right to written charges, notice of hearing, and a fair post-termination hearing before the board or administrative law judge from the Division of Administrative Hearing at the board's discretion. It was determined that the discharge was not based on substantial breach of contract or just cause. The attorney is entitled to the compensation and benefits from the date of discharge for the remainder of the contract term and shall not be entitled to reinstatement.
So, again, there, if you want to change direction, if we want to change the philosophy, if we're unhappy with the outcomes but can't point to some criminal activity or chronic malfeasance, we have to pay the full value of a three-year deal, which at this point is $450,000. That handcuffs the 2018 board. It handcuffs the 2020 board if we renew. I think that's unfair to the future. No principal or teacher that we have operates under anything remotely close to this. Correct me if I'm wrong on that. Like, I mean, do any of our principals have automatically renewing three-year deals?
No.
I think we all at this district level need to be accountable at the same level we're asking our teachers and our principals to be accountable. And I think this contract sends a terrible message to that effect, that it doesn't really matter what happens. You're gonna get reappointed, and for three years, and there's no mechanism for changing our direction. I mean, let's point out with Kat after Leroy that we had chronic mismanagement, and we had a whistleblower report, and we still couldn't get cause. We couldn't come close to getting cause because of the difficulty of proving cause. I think thank goodness we had a buyout clause or a severance clause in that contract, or she'd still be here today, most likely. And I think that's important to understand in this contract moving forward. If we non-renew today, all we have is Wes with a three-year deal. We have hurt ourselves not one bit at all. We have struck a little bit of a blow for accountability in a general sense. And if we're able to anyway, I think that's my point. We should start the clock on this contract and hold our attorney to the same level of accountability that we hold everybody else.
Mr. Wilson.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Over the time that Mr. Bridges has been here, the district has been involved in many actions, and I'm sure some of those actions were viewed unfavorably, and I think he's kind of in the face of that simply because he was the attorney. I think that Mr. Bridges has always acted under the direction of the school district and has always done what he thought was in the best interest of our school district. And I think he's always done, his heart has always been in the right place. I don't doubt that. Having said that, I do think that, it's important for our school district to adapt to a changing environment. And by the way, I want to be very clear about this. I had a conversation with Superintendent Byrd, and she and her staff have forgotten more about K-12 education than I will ever know. And there are board members here who have forgotten more about being board members than I will ever know. So I want to make this clear. This is just the opinion of one board member as I share these thoughts. It seems to me that it is terribly important that we reevaluate the culture of our district and that we do some things differently. I talked to a young man from another school district a few weeks ago, and by any standard, their school district is rated higher than ours. And I asked him, I said, why do you think your school district is performing better than our school district? He taught in a contract school. Contract schools, of course, are the schools that have a contract with the parent outlining the expectations of the students. And he said, number one, it's the principal. It's always the principal. He said, number two, very close second, is that contract, because that contract helps to engage parents and helps to engage students. And he said, everybody who serves at a contract school understands that there's a trade-off. In their district, the trade-off is that the lion's share of resources go to the non-contract schools. They get the new facilities, the new equipment, they get the extra pairs, they get the extra resource officers. And he felt like that was the what made them such a great school district. They had to rely on their PTO and their PTAs to help them out if they were in a contract school. You know, I talked to one of our teachers not so long ago who worked in a non-contract school. That school became a contract school. All of the students who were there previously were grandfathered in, and the vast majority of them, far and away the vast majority of them, signed the contract. Their parents signed the contract, and they came to that school. And this teacher explained to me that, and this was stunning to me, they said to me there were no, once they went to the contract, there were no behavioral issues. There were no disciplinary issues. And I said, you mean they were significantly reduced? They said, no, there were none. In their particular classroom, there were none. And it was this teacher's belief that there were none in the school, none they were aware of. And you know, that's just one solution. I'm sure there are many. And I know that Superintendent Bird and her staff will figure that out moving forward. But I do think we have to look towards a cultural change in our district. I think we owe it to our communities, to our stakeholders, to do a better job of listening. I think it's important that we find a way to get to yes. Oftentimes it seems like we don't do that. I think that if we're not very careful and we're not willing to make those changes, that our communities will take control of the schools within their respective communities. I think we've seen that happen in Lake Wales. I think it could be happening in another community in Polk County as we speak. So I think it is important that we think in terms of cultural change for our district. I think this is an appropriate time for us to consider not renewing the contract and looking at a fresh start. You know, it may be that if I had this conversation with Mr. Bridges, he might be the first one to say, you know, Lynn, I've been talking about cultural change since I've been here, and I haven't got any traction. He may be the first one to get on board with that. And a couple of years from now, we might find that he's leading that charge, and we may very much want him to stay here. But I do have issues with an evergreen contract, because there is no opportunity to terminate for convenience. You know, I think that at one time they were very popular with the public. I think they're not popular with the public any longer, and I think our legislature has heard that message and has established a law that I think may render those contracts essentially null and void, maybe not. I'm not an attorney, but I think that what the message that we were getting from our public is that those are not popular contracts, and they want us to take another look at those kinds of contracts. And it's not an indictment of Mr. Bridges. Let me be clear about that. It's the contract itself. And so I do think we should not renew that contract simply because it doesn't have that clause in it that allows us to terminate for convenience. And finally, let me say this, though. In the big picture, if my colleagues agree with me, if Superintendent Bird agrees with me, and we see our way forward to some changes in the district, we simply make that clear to our attorney, whoever is sitting in that seat. And I think that we could expect Mr. Bridges to be a part of that and to lead us in that change. So whoever's in that chair, I think the key is, as a board, that we agree how we want to move forward and how we want to adapt to a changing environment. So those are my thoughts, and you know, I think it should be on the board. I should think it should be added to the agenda this afternoon.
So, Mr. Murphy, I guess my question is, if there's a consensus, and we will determine that in a few minutes, that will impact Carol Matthews as well. Correct me if I'm wrong.
Based on the discussion that I just heard, it would appear.
And we haven't had any discussion about Carol Matthews. It's basically been Wes Bridges. Just want to make sure everybody understands that, because you can't do one without doing the other. And so,
I think this is disrespectful to both Mr. Bridges and Ms. Matthews at this short time. We've kind of been blindsided with this. I would want to do more research, contact more districts, find out what they're doing, because my concern is, when we've had people to come, search companies, they were telling us, in order to get a qualified person, people aren't going to uproot themselves and come and know that a board at a whim can say, oh, you're gone. I'm concerned about having quality people, an attorney, an internal auditor, quality people that have the history, have the knowledge, and have the experience to do the job. Maybe we would look at changing the contracts, but to blindside, especially Ms. Matthews, on a one day's notice, to me, is disrespectful to our employees. Mr. Bridges, we were hearing things from the community about dissatisfaction based on inaccurate information. I think the people sitting on this board, we recognized inaccuracies because we were involved in those situations. Today, we're sort of blindsided with let's change the contract and why. There may be a good reason to next year stop non-renewing it, but to do it this quickly at this time, especially Ms. Matthews is sitting here, this is the first she's heard of this. It's very disrespectful. And both of these employees have served us long and well in this district. So I would say this needs to have much more discussion, research, and thought before we, on a one day's notice, make this kind of change.
Okay, so when we entered the room today, I thought the discussion was purely about Mr. Bridges and that contract. What in our contracts require us to deal with Ms. Matthews? That doesn't make any sense to me.
Well, if you look at the exhibit that's attached to the memo, that was a notice that was for both.
From both of them,
Ms. Matthews,
but you can't deal with one, not the other? I mean,
you could if you wanted to, I suppose, but...
Okay.
You know, my understanding is that we were here to discuss Mr. Bridges
only, right?
Issue.
If it would help, I'm concerned about any contract structured in this way, regardless of who holds the contract. However, if we want to just stick to Wes's contract and not address, if it would help the situation to auto renew Ms. Matthews. Contract for a year and just address what Wes's, I wouldn't object to that. But, I do have an objection to this kind of contract as a whole, but out of, respect for her, that's fine with me.
I see your hands, Mr. Harris. And what I would say, I would ditto what Ms. Sellers just said. And how do you do one without the other? And be fair with the whole situation. And it's not fair for us to say, oh, well, we're going to just not renew Wes, but we'll keep Carol at least for another year. And then after the day, if I were Carol, I'd go to her and start looking for me another job, if I were Carol. And so I am not in support of the conversation of not renewing. And if there's consensus, we'll take it to the meeting today at 5, but I will not be in support of this. I'm not. Mr. Harris.
For my colleagues to consider, but also for the public to consider, if the roles were reversed, I think that a person would find it very disconcerting, maybe unconscionable, to be considered for dismissal by a person whom I've never sat down and met with. Never once had a face-to-face conversation, and that person's already determined I'm unfit for the job. I don't think any of us would want to be in that situation. I also think that if you've been in office for 3 weeks, and this is your first meeting, you don't have enough corporate history, enough cultural understanding to make this kind of proposal. Thank you.
And yet I have.
Mr. Wilson.
Well, I want to make it clear, I'm not suggesting dismissal. I want to make that perfectly clear.
Exactly.
What I'm suggesting is a contract, and, you know, at the end of that period of time, that would allow for termination for convenience. I think that's a reasonable clause in any contract. And so, from my perspective, it simply is a matter of saying those contracts are really not consistent with public policy any longer. And I think we have responsibility to take a look at that as a district. And it doesn't mean terminating Mr. Bridges. It just means that at the end of that, we can't renegotiate the contract at this point in time. That's not an option. But at the end of that, if we don't start that process, then we'll never have that opportunity. And there will never be, if at some point in time, and I do agree with Mr. Townsend on this, from this, as it relates to this, there could be an entirely new board 3 or 4 years from now. We have tied their hands to that contract, even if they feel like the person sitting in that seat, and this has nothing to do with Mr. Bridges, it has to do with whatever attorney is sitting in that seat, they would not have an opportunity to say, we're not happy with your performance. We want, it's not a good fit for us. We want you to move on. It would not be an option. That's not an option for us, frankly, right now. So I just want everyone to be clear about that. I don't see that as being an issue with Mr. Bridges, but it could be. And at that point in time, it is, as Mr. Townsend said, a $500,000 payout.
I mean, and just so you guys understand, if we non-renew today, all that happens is Carol and Wes are guaranteed employment essentially till sometime in 2019.
And then we have an opportunity to renew those contracts at that time.
Right.
Under
right.
A different
it's a 3-year deal then. You know, it's a sitting three-year deal, and it's still a very good deal because we have to pay them the full value of the contract or get them to agree to whatever amount they want. So it's not like we're dismissing anybody. It's clear. I mean, I should be clear. I would like to change the direction of the attorney. However, that's a different issue than the contract itself. And the contract itself is a bad contract for us. It's a bad contract for the public. And I think we should non-renew it so that we can have better contracts.
Ms. Harris?
Something Mr. Wilson just said that maybe isn't exactly per the contract. If you look at the current contract, paragraph 12 reads, this agreement shall not be amended or modified except by written agreement properly executed by the parties. Meaning there's nothing that stops us, if both sides agree, from modifying the current contract.
I think Mr. Bridges is going to agree to that one, wouldn't he?
I'm just saying that I don't want it left on the table that you can't change the contract. There is provision that it could be by mutual agreement.
I mean, it's if it's not an issue with Mr. Bridges, I want to point out that it would look awfully strange to change for contract's sake, because this is the first time we've had an opportunity to meet and talk about this. Social media is not a board conversation. This is the first time as a board we've sat down here. This is an important issue, and to bring it to a work session for the first time and discuss it with no extensive research, no extensive thought process, but to make a decision on the spur of the moment with two employees who in my eyes have done nothing but serve us well, and take it and vote on it a couple of hours later without giving them to be, put yourself in their position to be blindsided with a change in contract at this late date, because we evaluated them months ago. Wes gave us written notice. We had no indication to either one of them that this was going to be brought up. To bring it up at a work session and vote on it, because almost everything at least is brought up at the work session, and then 2 weeks later we vote on it and we have warning. This is blindsiding. Now, I know Mr. Bridges, because of social media, knew that there was some issues from one new board member. But Ms. Matthew, but now we're saying it's not about Mr. Bridges' work, it's about the contract. I'm telling you, to my way, it's inappropriate to do this to employees at the first time we meet, with no checking with other districts, having some thought process. Because once again, the experience and knowledge and background that Ms. Matthews has is invaluable. She's been nothing but a loyal, faithful employee to us. If, knowing her history, she was underpaid for many, many years. She worked at home with no compensation for that work at home for many, many years. I know the history of Ms. Matthews. And if it's about the contract, for us to do it to one employee and not the other is also strange and bizarre, to say we don't like these contracts, so let's change the attorneys and we'll change, because this is the first time we've talked about it. We don't do business in social media, so this is the first time we're blindsiding two people. So to me, it's not the appropriate time in this manner to do this to our employees. Put yourself in their position. How would you feel if glowing evaluations and at the last minute we do this to them? I don't think we treat any, I would not want any employees to be treated this way. And we may very well have these conversations, and unfortunately this is our last meeting, but this isn't the way we do business. We don't do things on the spur of the moment, and we don't depend on social media to make our decisions before we come to a board meeting amongst ourselves. We are always thoughtful, and we always do our research. This is not allowing us to do, and it's dangerous to make decisions on emotion and not give due process to our employees.
So awesome.
So I will say this, and this will be my last comments. We did not offer that contract to Mrs. LeRoy. So what if we had? That would have put us in an exceptionally difficult position. And quite honestly, I don't think anybody here believed that what happened would have ever happened. I don't think we anticipated that. We didn't see that coming. And I certainly don't think it's going to happen with either of these individuals. I don't think we're going to see that happen with them. But the point is, we put the district in a very precarious position with those types of contracts. I don't think we're saying that we want to terminate those individuals. I think what we're saying is we want them to have contracts that are consistent with good public policy. We didn't offer that type of contract to Mrs. LeRoy for good reason. And we probably, I would imagine as a board, we won't offer those in the future. I think the public will not be happy with that. For that very reason, we don't know what's coming down the road. We don't know what any employee is, you know, what's going to happen with them. We certainly, as I said, and I will reiterate this, didn't see that coming, you know, see those situations occurring with Mrs. LeRoy. I would have never guessed that. I would have never saw that coming down the road. So that would have been a public policy disaster, I think, if she had had that kind of contract. So that's where I'm coming from on this. And it's not to suggest they can't have a three-year contract. It just has to have that clause in it that says that we can terminate for convenience if something goes wrong.
Just a minute.
Go ahead.
Mr. Murphy, you have any comments? You've heard everybody's comments for the most part. Do you have any comments on what you're hearing?
I'm hearing that there are some board members who desire to have a different type of contract. That's fine, but that means that there would have to be some voluntary agreement amongst the contracting parties for that to occur. And right now, you have a contract that is spelled out pretty clearly, whether you like it or not. It exists. There are, you know, mechanisms in place to have certain things happen, and you are now faced with, I guess, the decision or determining whether or not you desire to have any particular action at your meeting later this evening. But I would tell you that if there are, that Mr. Harris, I think his point was well taken, and that is, this contract, any contract for that matter, is always subject to further review and further amendment if the parties agree to that. That's not really the, so to suggest that you're locked in, that's not necessarily correct. But I mean, this is a policy. These are deliberations for the board to make.
Okay, thank you.
And,
Ms. Cunningham?
Well, a couple of things, you know. First of all, the reason we're here today, kind of to piggyback on what Hazel said, is because a certain event occurred that I think triggered all of this, and that was Wes's resignation. Let's be upfront about it. But the elephant right there, had we not gotten that resignation, I don't know that we would be where we are today. In business, if you resign from a position, it means you have other intentions, and if you're not going to leave today, it might be tomorrow, it might be in a week, it might be in a year. I don't know what his future plans are. That's a personal decision between him and his family. Okay, so that's why we're even probably talking about it. So I think there was a trigger mechanism in my mind that made me think, that's interesting. Okay, and then the fact that when the resignation letter was provided to us, it didn't even follow his contract. It said give 5 months notice. We gave, 2 months, but essentially with Thanksgiving and Christmas, less than a month. So that questions in my mind a little bit, the individual, of course, and why you would do that. And, you know, how can we find a replacement and have a transition in less than a month over the holidays? So just, you said, you know, why are we doing this? I feel like there's a reason it's come up. There's something that happened that triggered this. Now, I'm all about fairness and equity. Y'all know me. Y'all know my heart. This is not about Wes Bridges at the moment. I understand that there's issues about the contract. Do I like the contract? No, not really. Do I think we could do probably better? I think we could. So my question is, and I'm poor John, you're on the hot spot today, dear. If we don't like the contract, how do we have an opportunity? I understand that if we do not renew, that forces us into looking at the contract to do something after the 3 years is up. I get that. But is there some way to keep the integrity of the group and be able to talk about making some changes, and I don't know exactly what that is, whether it's an annual contract or what. You know, I could understand where he would say, wait a second, I have a 3-year contract, I'm not budging, but after that point in time, we probably need to look at amending the way in which we do business. Is necessarily today the day? Maybe not, but then my question is, as he pointed out, can we discuss this out in another session and say, okay, you know, up to 3 years, you're fine, but after that, we need to look at changing the contract or the way in which the contract is done, whether, I don't know what you're looking for, quite frankly, we haven't really talked about it. Are you looking for an year-by-year renewal, or help me understand?
Mostly what I have in mind is that clause in there that says that we can terminate for convenience, which was in Mrs. Lavoie's contract. That's why she got the 20
with
weeks.
The severance, right.
As opposed to a 3-year payout. You know, it's my personal opinion that everyone should be on an annual contract, but my colleagues may not agree with me. But I do think the most important thing is that clause that says that there's an opportunity to terminate for convenience. And then they just get, you know, the 5 months, which is by state statute. I mean, our legislators were hearing that from our constituents. So that's why they did that.
Okay. So we would be able to do that. The only way we could do that.
Okay. I'm not sure I understand. Let me try to put some context into that.
Okay.
I think your question was, can the board have further discussions about this matter? Most certainly. The board can have discussions about whatever is appropriate for the board to discuss at any point in time. I guess the question inferred, could this contract change over the next...
3 years.
3 years.
Prior to, right, that's my question.
And I think the answer to that question is, yes, it depends.
Right.
It would have to be a mutual undertaking between both parties.
Okay.
The board could not unilaterally, I don't believe, impose a change.
No.
In the absence of an agreement from, in this instance, Mr. Bridges. But in terms of, can the board have further discussions, and yes, I mean, the board is certainly...
I meant before the 3 years is up.
Sure.
To do it beforehand.
Well, acknowledging hands, Mr. Harris, and then Mr. Townsend, and then Ms. Sellers.
Board members, we do have the flexibility to direct our chair to have negotiations with both contractees to see if there's any way that these two contracts could be modified. And then she could come back to us with that results of the conversation. We could move forward with that and move this conversation on down the road.
If we don't act today to non-renew the contract, we extend the contract out past 2020. It's into 2020 now. If we act today and we non-renew the contract, all that happens is that our internal auditor and our school board attorney have 3-year contracts in place with no termination for convenience clauses. Those are still really, 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 really good contracts for them. I don't work on a contract. You know, like the... All we're doing today is not renewing it another year on the backside. They still have a full clock. They still have all the leverage in their negotiations against us. Honestly, I think nothing happens to them except that they're not guaranteed employment out past 2020. We don't tie the hands of another board. You know, we're already tying the 2018 board's hands. We would tie the hands of another board, the 2020 board's hands. The only reason we have to, this is urgency today, because we have no other meeting scheduled. I mean, if they wanted to waive the January 1st clause and have it till March 1st, you know, and for us to give a non-renew, we could have a work session in January. I don't care. My point is not to wait another year. You know, it's the timing of it. That's where this urgency comes from. And with respect, this isn't a blind side. I mean, the we've been talking about this for a long, long time, or at least I have. And you know, I tried to make it very, very clear where I stood on this. I did not understand Ms. Matthews' contract was bound up in it, and I actually talked to her this morning. I'm happy to delay it for a month or two and to allow for further discussion if they will agree to it, because it's their contract. They don't have to. I can say decide today or not decide today. It's their role. But if we non-renew, nothing happens to them. They still have 3-year deals, which are better than anybody else in this district has. Jackie doesn't have a three-year deal. No principal has a three-year deal. Certainly no teacher has a three-year deal. You know, I guess we board members kind of have 4-year deals, but, you know, those are revocable at almost any time. So I guess that's the thing we need to understand.
Ms. Sellers.
Once again, we have to remember we do business as a board. This was not brought up. This is the first day this was brought up. Once again, I know what was out there in the social media from one person's perspective. Much of that inaccurate. So this came up. I didn't even know the contracts were on the thing unless you read the website. And I'm not responding. Remember, we can't do business outside of this board. It's unfortunate that we don't have any time, but we as a board never brought this up, ever. Ms. Matthews and Mr. Bridges did not know this was even on our radar to look at the contracts. To me, it's a vote of non-confidence. We're calling it a just the contract issue on one point, but then we're deciding maybe we'll do it with one and one with another. This is important business, and to do it, to bring it up for the first time in a work session to act on is rash, and if I were sitting in either one of